Thank you very much for the introduction. Today I would like to present the results of a case study from a mature brownfield with lots of water injection, where we tried to make a model for data-driven estimates of reservoir properties using 3D and 4D seismic measurements and well log as a calibration data sets. What we really tried to do in this project is actually to improve oil recovery from a mature field. I know it's not obvious from the name, but that's actually what we try to do every day in all companies. So how do we do it? Well, that's simple. Let's drill more wells that find oil and less wells that find water. That's easy to say. So how to do it? How to locate the unswept oil pockets? Traditionally, we built models, simulation models, rock physics models that use very complicated equations, lots of parameters, quite complex. And there are two main assumptions that actually real reservoir rock can model using equations. That's a strong assumption already. And then that we know how those parameters are distributed in 3D. And I can promise you, when you drill down to 3,000 meters depth, you're guaranteed to have surprises, even if you try to work hard and make very complicated models. So let's see how data analytics can help us to get surprises, but only pleasant ones. So what we're trying to do here is to get estimates of pressure, saturation, and porosity directly from seismic observations using well logs, porosity and saturation well logs, RFT pressure measurements, in order to calibrate and correlate and find correlations. The benefits are quite clear. We can find an independent source of information, how the water is located in the reservoir, and where is oil. We can eventually, if everything works, we can drill less water wells and less sidetracks, save a lot of money and produce more oil. So it was a compact project with a small team working for 3 months where we tried to prove the concept and see if there are some promising results that can be getting out of it. So first, let's see how we can prepare the data. We have acquired a set of seismic surveys over the years. Here we used data sets from 2010 and 16. Elastic impedance inversion, near angle, far angle stacks, mid angle too. Then over this period of years, we drilled around 60 wells where we collected water saturation, porosity and saturation and pressure. Then we need to bring it to the same format and collect it all in tables. And table is very good. I like table more than wiggles to work with. Can be very wide table, can be very long table, but then we can use any type of analytics and script afterwards. And this conceptual sketch looks quite easy, but in reality, there is lots of issues with the data. First of all, we need to find it. Second, bring it to the same format. And big problem is actually the resolution of our data. When we're talking about seismic, the lateral resolution is limited by the size of Fresnel zone. The vertical resolution is limited by the wavelength and frequency. So we're talking about tens and hundreds of feet resolution. When we're talking about well logs, they are sampled more frequently than 1 foot. There's lots of data and lots of details. So we try to bring them into comparable scale. We split the data into voxels, 100 feet size, can be different size. And then we take average values within those voxels. So inevitably, you introduce errors already at this stage. So for example, if you look at the black points, which is the 100 feet average, by just making this upscaling, you already lost some peaks. And that can be just noise or can be very important source of information. Then the pressure. We collect pressure only a few points along the well. Then we need to interpolate it to make it to the same voxels. And then we can use different types of interpolation, can be linear, polynom, whatever. And we always introduce errors compared to the more frequent data and correlations that we use. Then there is a sample bias. When we plan a well location, we try to do a very good job. So we don't want to drill, you know, water locations. So our data set is already very biased because it takes into account all our prior knowledge before we drill it. So for example, if you take this formation and data points from this formation, high water saturation, you can see that in the northern part of the field, there is no observations with high water. So what does it mean? Is there no water in reservoir, or we just haven't drilled it yet? So would any machine learning be able to predict high water saturation if it's only trained on oil samples here in this part? Maybe, it's not obvious to me that this is the case. So you would might consider to introduce some control points or enrich your data set with other observations in order to avoid the sample bias. Then when it comes to validation, the only true source of information is actually well-logged observations. This we can compare and use for validation purposes. But when it comes in between the wells, then we have only reservoir simulation model as a reference. And reservoir simulation model is a subject to history match uncertainty and quality. Sometimes it's perfect, sometimes it's very wrong. And also, if you look at this well trajectory, you see it's drilled just in between the cell locations in our reservoir simulation model. So if you want to compare the observed saturation with predicted one, you take cell to the left, it's full of oil, cell to the right, it's full of water. So which one do you choose for your comparison? So I don't know if we have some well planning or drilling people here, but please stop drill wells like this. We can't use them anymore. So all in all, we are kind of similar to the scientists from NASA when they were trying to get images of Pluto. And it's only recently that the satellite reached enough distance so we can look into more details. So we're dealing with data at a very different resolution. What data do we have? How does it look like? Does it have any physical meaning? So let's just plot the data we have, number of cross plots. Here you can see the elastic impedance versus porosity. Okay, it's decreasing with the porosity increase. Makes perfect physical sense. The same plot for the saturation also makes sense, but weaker correlation. Then you have just observations in wells, saturation versus porosity, and the ratio of seismic attributes that's supposed to react on pressure and saturation changes. So here you have an immediate problem for any functional analysis. You have one value of porosity and lots of corresponding value of saturation. There are a number of reasons for that. You have crest versus flank locations, you have injection water, formation water, lots of things why it might happen. See, if we start to put more information on top, let's say here we put a color as a pressure interval, you can see that for different pressure intervals, you would have a different shape in corresponding plots. That also makes perfect sense. Seismic is reactive to pressure. So if we are to find the best location to drill, which is the high porosity and low saturation, that's what we should aim. And if we want to find the worst location to drill, which is high saturation and low porosity, that's how it's reflected in our data set, and that's how it's reflected on seismic. So this data is available only at well level. This data is available everywhere in the field. If we can establish correlation on well level, then we can propagate it in 3D using seismic. So I flip-flop, you know, back and forth. You can see that those intervals are kind of detectable in seismic too. So we continue to split our data into more intervals and regions. You can see that, for example, this is seismic versus saturation. If we split it into porosity intervals and pressure intervals, in some areas or zones or clusters, we can see a very strong correlation between seismic and saturation. In some areas, not so strong. In some, there's hardly any correlation. So the real task of this particular study was to find a way to split our data, well logs and seismic, into the clusters or regions where we can find a strong correlation between seismic and observations. And we've been very creative here. We've tried lots of different techniques, like all of them, and maybe even more. And we found that the method that actually works quite well are the most simple methods and easy to understand. And we've landed on those. And it's also important that we can easily communicate how this method works across the organization. So that improves the trust for the results. Okay, how do we do the prediction part? Let me illustrate the concept. So let's say we have a well. Then along the well, we found the rock type, certain intervals of pressure, porosity, and saturation, and corresponding seismic types. Call it seismic type one. Later, along the very long well, we found another rock type with a different combination of properties and a different corresponding seismic patterns. And then we split it into categories of high, low, and medium saturation. Why? Because it's much easier to predict categories first, solve a classification problem, and then try to find clusters and saturation, then try to predict saturation absolute values from the beginning. Elsewhere in the field, we can find the same rock types, the same corresponding seismic types, and the same categories. and establish a correlation and train our machine learning model at well level. So now we have a future well to plan. There is only seismic available. So we look for the seismic patterns, the same categories, the same clusters, and then we can find the rock types. So the software implementation is here. We start with data select, transform, filter, interpolate, get a huge well master table. Then we do initial clustering of seismic and reservoir properties, define clusters, distributions within the clusters, get factors, categories. Then we predict categories using the different machine learning methods. And we use current packaging R to optimize the parameters. Then within the clusters, we predict saturations and clusters within categories using random forest. And then we get a model that we score in 3D for seismic. So that's the agenda. I've been through the introduction and methodology review. Now let's see the results of the workflow. So here you can see a dashboard showing the results of clustering at well level. So here you can see a cross plot of cluster number and the range of outcomes for the saturation, porosity within the cluster, pressure, and seismic. And that's how they're distributed across the field. So if I highlight just a couple of clusters, numbers 3 and 4, you can see that the range of porosity is quite similar. Might be different distribution, but the range is similar. Range of porosity and saturation are similar, pressure more or less the same. But why are they different clusters? That's because the seismic is quite different. And why is that? Well, there might be numerous reasons. It might be different part of the field, different formation, different thickness, tuning, noise. And at this stage, I don't really want to know why. I just want to make sure that my algorithm detects that they should be in different clusters and treat them differently. So when it comes to the blind tests, so we trained our models for the data set between 2010 and 16. Then we used wells drilled in 2017-18, roughly 30-40 wells for a blind test. And that's just a few examples of observed saturation along the horizontal wells in black and scored from seismic in red. So you can see that overall there is a quite a good correspondence, but every now and then you might see some sudden jumps in the data, in the scored results. Let's look into details into this well, for example. Here we come to the fundamental problem with all the subsurface and data analytics projects is the quality of our data and input. So in our reservoir, we have lots of faults. Big faults, small faults, seismic, subseismic. And naturally, seismic amplitude deteriorates in the fault shadow zones. So if we take this well and we highlight the faulted zones that the well crossed, and we just remove it from the training set, and validation set, then you can see that the data corresponds and results are almost identical. So all in all, even if you just do this simple cleaning, if we take all the blind test wells in 2017 and 18, and if we specify the ranges what we consider to be a good prediction, we're talking about 81-84% of prediction quality in the observed voxels. That's not bad at all. What about 3D? Well, here is a problem, because we don't really have a reference to understand our properties in 3D. So here on this plot, you can see the simulation model, three different sources of information, scored from seismic in 3D. And on top, you have a polygons of a manual interpretation of your waterfronts. So color here is water saturation, red is oil, bluish is water. So you can see, for example, here there is a good correspondence between all these alternative three sources of information. If you look at different parts of the field, you can find areas where, scored from seismic is in better accordance with manual interpretation, somewhere the model is better. So how do we intend to use it? We would like to combine all these different and independent sources of information. And if they all coincide, that increases our probability of success to find oil. And if they all show different, then we should spend more time on this region and plan a well more carefully. So I'm about to conclude my presentation. So today I've showed you the introduction and the motivation, the methodology that we identified to predict the reservoir properties, and I showed you results of validation at well level and 3D level. So all in all, the project has achieved its goal. We proved the concept in a time and small team. So what we have learned is the key to success is to have an agile project management approach where we work in a close collaboration between all the disciplines, subsurface and data science. We test fail, test fast, we fail fast, and adjust fast. So it's a very interactive process. The workflow is based on data. The more data we provide, the better would be the results. So it's shaped up well to receive the new data from the subsurface data lake, new wells, new models, other observations. It's very quick to run. It takes only 10 minutes at my local machine to start from well logs and get the scored seismic, scored data in 3D using seismic. And overall, this type of data gives us an additional source of information that we can use in our multidisciplinary discussions and improve our decision making in Reservoir. In the end, I would like to thank the license partners that allowed to publish this work and present it. And thank you very much for your attention.